Hello everyone, this is JR Jason. Welcome back to J Gamer Channel. Today we're gonna play another episode on Honkai Star Rail. I hope you guys enjoyed this series. If you like it, give it a thumbs up. If you want to see more, please remember to subscribe to my channel and hit the bell notifications. Yes, thank you. It will help me out a lot. Let's begin.
We can ask Jesse for help. I've gotten to know many locals while waiting for you guys. Everyone here is living a self-sufficient life. I don't know how to describe it, but this place feels like the real dreamscape.
Self-sufficient.
Evening, Jesse. Is it evening?
Welcome, Miss March. Who might these be?
These two are my friends. As for the man lying on the ground, he's a scaredy cat who fainted from fright.
I see. Another poor guy who accidentally ended up here. I'll take care of him. There have been a lot of new faces lately. Things must be tough in the beautiful dream. The few remaining havens of freedom in Asdana will soon face trouble.
Asdana?
Do such things often happen here?
Not really, but they're becoming more frequent now. Guess it's one of the signs of the sweet dreams collapse. This man has had quite the shock. Could you help me find a Helovian lady, March? Her songs can heal mental wounds.
Ooh, who's that?
A Helovian lady?
That must be Robin. She's also here in Dreamflux Reef.
Robin? But I thought she... Oh, right! If Firefly is here safe and sound, then it means Robin must be okay too.
Yep. Misha is about to take us to her to find out what happened. But before that, let's meet up with Himiko. You were with her earlier, right?
We met some stowaways in the residential area. Most of them came from neighboring star systems.
Oh.
I heard that places like Dreamflux Reef are scattered throughout the memory zone of Asdana, like islands in the ocean. They existed before the family arrived.
Oh, okay.
I also heard that when Dreamflux Reef took shape, it was the center of all dreamscapes in Penacony.
If that's true, it's no wonder there are so many similarities between this place and the Sweet Dream.
Himiko must be gathering information. Let's hurry up and get going. This is where we split up.
So that's how it is. I never imagined we'd gather the remaining details here.
What is dashing, good-looking, mature man? What is this dashing, good-looking, mature, daddy-looking man?
To borrow Gallagher's catchphrase, what an unpredictable twist of fate.
Himiko, here they are!
Perfect timing. Now that everyone's here, I'd like to introduce everyone to Micah, who's partly in charge of the Land of the Exiles. Micah, these are my companions.
It's a pleasure to meet the Nameless.
You know us?
I've been keeping an eye on you since the day you arrived in Penacony.
Oh.
We would have met under more appropriate circumstances if Dreamflux Reef hadn't been isolated from the 12 Dreamscapes. Please, allow me to formally introduce myself. I'm Micah, the Gravekeeper of Dreamflux Reef.
Gravekeeper?
Of course, these are the people who were exiled from the Dreamscape.
Life in Dreamflux Reef is pretty liberating. Everyone here mostly keeps to themselves, without meddling in others' affairs. My daily task involves cleaning a few tombstones.
You're too modest, Micah. When lost dream chasers stumble upon this place, you're the one who takes care of them, guiding them back to the Sweet Dream, or showing them how to survive the wild dream chaos.
So, guardian of sorts. Were you talking to me, Mr. Yang?
Mm-hmm. On that note, Mr. Mika, which tombstones are you referring to? We didn't come across any graveyard when we arrived.
They're actually just symbolic stones. But since you're curious, Mr. Yang, I'll take you there. I have a feeling you might find something of interest there. But before that, you have an important guest joining you.
An important guest? Who could it be?
This way, please. The roads here in Dreamflux Reef are a bit run down, so watch your step.
So this is the circle.
I still like to look at the sky. It's pretty. Even though it's like another underwear, then the sky is overwear. Where are we heading?
Everyone sang so wonderfully. It's not often that I tried this music style, but I've gained some valuable insights from it.
Sorry.
Oh, I can't thank you enough, Robin. Well, these kids have made incredible progress in only a few days.
It was nothing, Grace. I merely taught them how to sing. It was you who brought hope into their lives. Life must be quite difficult for them in reality, I imagine.
That's right.
Whenever it's time to say goodbye to these kids, they're reluctant to leave. But I've explored every corner of Dreamflux Reef, talked to everyone I met, and they all told me the same thing. This shattered dream is not worth clinging to.
It seems you truly are a child of the Harmony. Emma and Andy are orphans I took under my wing. Carol there, with her blind eyes, used to work at a nutrition center in the outer ring of Penacony. And as for Gary, he's been living with autism since he was a child. They're not old enough to enter the sweet dream managed by the family. If we compare people to birds, these kids are like fledglings with impaired wings. But in this dream, well, they can fly freely. Even if they stumble along the way, well, they're still relying on their own strength. And me, an old lady with no legs. Well, without this dream, I couldn't even walk toward them.
I'm glad that you found a new life here in Penacony. It's just...
Don't worry, Robin. Dreams have their significance, but they aren't everything. Both the children and I understand this. No matter how long we fly through this dream, we will one day return to reality. But you know what? Emma and Gary aren't plagued by their insecurities anymore. No, and Carol is learning how to cope with her blindness. And Andy is livelier than ever. Well, even I've become more optimistic. You see, in dreams, we learn how to live. Once we return to reality, we learn how to survive.
Interesting.
And should our feathers be damaged, then we share our wings with one another. There's no need to covet an illusory sky in dreams, because we have the right and the ability to fly towards a broader horizon.
It's a relief to see you safe and sound, Miss Robin.
It's nice to see you all again, Astral Express crew. I heard my disappearance caused quite the commotion out there. I'm really sorry about that.
Since you're here, can we assume that you're fully aware of the situation in Penacony?
Ever since I returned to Penacony, my voice started to change, until it gradually faded away. At first, I thought it was a temporary ailment. Perhaps due to having been away too long. I thought maybe it just takes some time for my body to acclimate to the high concentration of Memoria and Asdana. But now it seems the root of the problem goes way beyond me. There are elements around me that don't align with the Harmony. Losing my voice is just one of the signs of the Sweet Dreams collapse.
The Sweet Dreams collapse? That memo keeper mentioned the same thing. So it's real.
While I was away from Penacony, the boundaries of the 12 dreamscapes kept expanding outward. Whenever I mentioned the anomalies in my dreams, all the family heads refused to talk about it. Only my brother was willing to respond. Later, I discovered the secret letters from the IPC ambassador, which further convinced me that there are hidden secrets beneath the surface of Penacony. So, following the clues in the Oak family's dossiers, I found my way here, the land of the exiles, concealed by the family under the guise of death. A dream within a dream, where Penacony's past is buried.
Hearing you speak, it sounds as if your voice has made somewhat of a recovery.
I hate to admit it, but the Harmony in this place resonates more broadly than within the Sweet Dream. It's regrettable. But the family has experienced betrayal. The traitor, or traitors, abandoned their original principles and, using the name of Harmony, exploited people's weaknesses to turn Penacony into the planet of festivities, trapping everyone in the illusion of the Sweet Dream. This is not the strong defending the weak, but rather the strong exploiting the weak. A world without equality won't ever be favored by the Harmony. And naturally, those voices blessed by them have lost the ability to sing.
Could there be another force influencing the family's shift in philosophy, Miss Robin? Considering what happened with Acheron, it's difficult to conceive of another entity within the realm of the Harmony capable of influencing everyone. Unless a power surpassing that of an emanator is involved.
I'd heard about what happened to the Cienjo Alliance. But as far as I'm aware, the family hasn't faced any such external interventions. Who knows? Perhaps I've just been away too long and missed something. Regardless, I cannot accept my home is moving towards the very opposite of what the Harmony represents, while still claiming to uphold it. I must uncover the reason why Mikhail cut ties with the family, and who exactly it was who betrayed us all. Do you remember our arrangement, Mr. Micah? Well, here's my answer. I've decided to forgo my role, and never step foot on the Charmony Festival stage again.
What? Really?
Look here, brother. A little bird.
Looks like a fledgling Charmony dove. But Charmony doves don't live here. So how did this little bird get here? Maybe its parents abandoned?
It looks weak and frail. Why don't we find something soft and make a nest for it?
This place is too dangerous for a fledgling. Let's take it with us. We can put it on the wooden shelf in front of your window.
Okay. A bird like that must have a beautiful singing voice. But where will it live?
I'll ask the family head to build a cage for it.
Mm. A cage? But then it won't have the freedom to fly.
Let's see. What is it that has captured the attention of the two best interpreters of the Great One? To the point that they've forgotten how to enjoy their dessert? Oh, poor little thing. Doesn't look like it's doing well.
I do. But I don't want to lock it up in a cage.
Why?
Why?
Even if it's small and not fully feathered, and can't sing, it didn't come into this world just to be locked up in a cage. Birds, they should be flying free in the sky.
That's quite the romantic idea. And what about you, our young scholar?
Do you agree with your sister?
I think she's right. But if we leave it out in the wild, it won't survive for more than a few days at best.
Ah, I see. It seems our little scholar is still a bit unsure. Well, let me tell you youngsters a story. As you probably know, Charmany doves can fly through the air. When they fly really high, the friction caused by the flapping of their feathers against the atmosphere creates amazing lights so that they look like shooting stars.
Oh, really?
We've seen this spectacle so many times that we think it's just something they can naturally do. But that's not the truth. Their radiant display is the result of countless struggles against nature over generations. Their ancestors were too weak to survive on the ground. So, to escape predators, they started seeking new opportunities in the air. After countless attempts by many generations, one of them finally figured out how to fly. It soared into the sky and never looked back at the ground again.
So, you mean birds aren't born to fly? They find a way to do it through their determination?
Well, that's an idealistic way of putting it. So, what are your thoughts, Sunday?
I think people believe birds are meant to fly because they've never seen those birds crashing to their death.
That's an interesting perspective. So, have you decided what to do with the bird now?
For now, I'll keep it in a cage until it can take care of itself because I want it to live, no matter what.
Well said, kids. It seems each of you has found your own answer. Your insights are truly remarkable, and I hope they come true in their own way.
We will take good care of it, won't we, brother?
Yeah, but Mr. Gopherwood? There's one thing I don't quite understand.
And what might that be?
What if this little Charmany dove never learns to fly in the end? I mean, if there are fledglings in this world that can never fly throughout their lives, should we let them go back to the sky? Only to see them crash to the ground and die?
Hmm. Talking in your sleep, Birdie? Time to wake up.
Now you're here.
Huh? Need a hand?
Still alive?
Yeah. Happy about that.
Where is Robin? Tell me.
I knew that was going to be the first thing you'd ask. Don't worry, your sister is here, safe and sound. She's probably walking around the streets now. If I were you, I'd be more worried about myself. After all, right in front of you is the guy who just stabbed you in the chest with a...
If you wanted to kill me, you wouldn't give me the chance to speak. Just tell me your demands, lackey of the Watchmaker.
So, you figured out who I am, huh? No wonder you had the guts to go against the Dream Master and the four families. Looks like I made the right choice.
Choice?
You are aware of my plan and see through my act. Time is running out, so let's drop the charades. I'm suggesting we cooperate.
Cooperate? What makes you think I'd cooperate with you?
The fact that the famous Robin has chosen my side. Plus, some clues about a traitor and a bright future for Pentaconi. Any of that catch your interest?
I find it hard to believe a man who's full of deception.
Fine. You don't have to trust me. What you should trust is the sense of justice inside of you.
Show me Robin first.
All right. As you wish. Here she is.
Huh? This Firefly.
What's your trick this time?
Just kidding. I mean, this lady will lead us to Robin, right?
And the crew, too. There are too many people who you owe.
An explanation.
That'd be great. Please follow me, Honorable Oak Family Head. Now, all the actors are on the stage.
This is the monument I mentioned earlier. The name's inscribed on it. Should be familiar to all of you.
Rosalina and Tiernan.
When Pentaconi was known as a frontier prison, it was the trailblazers who connected it with the stars. They were the heroes who saved Asdana,
and their names deserve to be immortalized. Not just on the small stone tablet, but in the annals of history for all of time. However, today, the planet of festivities is nothing but sweet dreams. That heavy piece of history is all a distant memory. Just like that prison.
If their names are inscribed here, then that means...
According to Micah, they died long ago.
Rosalina was killed during the War of Independence. She ventured alone into the heart of the star system to investigate the flow of Memoria, but...
Oh.
She never returned. Tiernan was a skilled gunslinger, strong and reliable. He led the people through countless battles, but he didn't live long enough to witness the arrival of true peace.
Gunslinger? It sounds like Boot Hugh.
In the decade following the war, Penacony faced challenges internal and external. To protect Asdana, Tiernan took up the way of the Trailblaze and led the Lampmoth family to explore beyond the system, only to be surrounded and wiped out by the Swarm.
Lampmoth family?
Though I had expected as much, the tales of these heroes truly are sorrowful.
True to the title of Trailblazer, they spent their lives venturing into the unknown. But what about this tablet? There are no names carved on it.
When Dreamflux Reef was created, its owner was still alive. However, he insisted on erecting a monument for himself, saying that it will happen someday.
The Watchmaker?
Here we meet again. Everyone from the Astral Express.
Robin!
Huh. The atmosphere sure is livened up with all these people in here.
Well, I did my job. I gathered everyone here. Gallagher will explain the rest to you. Take care.
Brother.
There's no need for words. You're safe. And that's all that matters.
Brother.
There's no need for words.
I brought Gallagher here. It's time to face the truth.
Okay. But it's the truth.
I promised to give the siblings some privacy. So let's talk about our business first.
That sounds sensible enough. Since you went through the trouble of gathering the family head, the crew, and the Stellaron hunters, I'm guessing you have something important to say, Mr. Gallagher?
Oh, is it that obvious?
The look on your face is practically screaming, I'm the one behind all this.
You're right, Mr. Yang. It is indeed time to come clean on everything. The siblings already know what they need to, and they've made their choice. But you, Nameless, arrived a bit late. So it's only fair that I answer your questions. Before we begin, let me reintroduce myself. I'm the founder of Dreamflux Reef, the deputy of the Watchmaker, and the one who sent out that invitation. As Gallagher, the history fictionologist, I humbly extend my greetings to you all.
History fictionologist? So what, everything you told us was made up?
Well, don't worry. Almost everything I shared was true. Well, except for the part about the family accepting me back.
I double-checked with Micah, and everything he said about the family, the Watchmaker, and Mikhail is true.
Thank you for your understanding. Now let's get down to business. I'm sure you're all wondering why I went through the trouble of setting up this battle for the Legacy, inviting different factions, and stirring up a ruckus all over Penacony. Well, it all boils down to something very familiar to all of you. The Stellaron.
The Stellaron? But how is that possible? Penacony is a free-flowing interstellar hub. There are no signs of contamination whatsoever.
You're totally correct. So, care to take a guess at what that means?
Someone is manipulating the Stellaron?
How keen. Well, what should I say? I expected nothing less from the person here who is the most familiar with Stellarons. The sweet dream doesn't come out of thin air. If you think of the memory zone as the sea, creating the land of the dreams is like filling that wild ocean with earth to make an island. To achieve this feat, without the help of an emanator of remembrance or enigmata, the only way is to use a Stellaron. And that's not something you can achieve with a simple wish. It requires vast quantities of knowledge, time, and manpower. I'm sure you get what I'm hinting at. In Asdana, the planet of festivities itself is a Stellaron disaster.
The planet of festivities itself is a Stellaron disaster?
It all started a long time ago, back when the Watchmaker and his crew liberated the Frontier Prison. They faced countless challenges as they began building Penacony from the ground up. That's when the idea of using the Stellaron came into play. The Stellaron first entered the Asdana system during the war. The Nameless warned everyone against the folly of attempting to tamper with such a power, and most heeded their words. But there are always people in the shadows, but they'll tear your motives. The turning point came after Tiernan's death. With two of the Nameless gone, the Watchmaker had to go to the front lines. It was at that moment his rivals saw an opportunity. By the time a representative from the Montour system's family arrived at the Watchmaker's call, the Stellaron had already been activated and was seeping into the primordial synesthesia dreamscape.
And I suppose the family happened to possess the knowledge to seal the Stellaron?
Not just that. They knew far more about the Stellaron than the average person. They helped Mikhail swiftly quell the civil unrest and played a part in building Penacony under the disguise of the Harmony. Those three eras were known as the Age of Dreaming. The Watchmaker, who had been left in the dark, sent out invitations across the universe, spreading the hype around the land of the dreams.
Then, how did they turn against each other?
Remember the island in the ocean metaphor? The truth is, the Stellaron was never truly sealed. It existed in a different form within the dreamscape. Think about this. What would it cost to create and maintain such a lavish dreamland? It's people's lives. The opulent dream is built upon the decay of spirits, with a toxic elixir called pleasure flowing through the dreamscape. It tempts people to indulge in the dreamscape, and gradually their minds succumb, becoming nourishment for the sweet dream.
Okay.
Confusion, laziness, and cowardice, weaknesses that plague humanity, were magnified and nourished by the family. Penacony became a new kind of prison, even more impenetrable than the previous one. Sadly, we realized this far too late. By then, the family had a firm grip on Penacony, swiftly quelling any opposition that arose. At my wit's end, I had to use the power of the Enigmata and sought refuge in this chaotic realm. Over the years, I created a meme within this dream for our use. Dormancy. That's its real name. We exploited a loophole. You see, regular people can't fall asleep again while they are inside the dreamscape.
So this is the true meaning of the impossible. You sent out invitations in the Watchmaker's name to find forces capable of resolving the Stellaron disaster and draw them into Penacony to uncover the truth.
It's not just that. Above all, I wanted to see what happens when the major factions engage in a struggle for the legacy. Since this is the Watchmaker's first announcement in decades, the traitor within the family is bound to reveal themselves.
So, the legacy is just a facade.
If you want to consider the Stellaron as the legacy, I'm totally fine with that.
If that's the case, where is the Stellaron now?
That's a question for Mr. Wings. The Stellaron is still under the family's control, and as the head of the Oak family, I'm sure he holds all the answers. Go ahead. I'm sure Mr. Wings holds all the answers.
Okay.
Are you done talking? So, will you tell us where the Stellaron is?
It is the Penacony Grand Theater itself.
As I suspected, it's the embodiment of the family. The edifice that first materialized within the sweet dream. That's what turned Penacony into its current state.
As for the person who employed its power, it is in fact Mr. Gopherwood, the current Dream Master.
Well, that was easier than I thought. Did you conduct your own investigation already?
Correct. When I was trying to track down the person who murdered my sister, apart from you, Gopherwood was my second suspect.
Confronting me first turned out to be a smart move on your part.
I didn't have other options. The Dream Master has been elusive, and even the heads of the families can hardly get an audience with him. Moreover, Mr. Gopherwood has been kind to my sister and me. And I didn't want it all to end like this.
What do you mean by that?
To be honest, my brother and I are also victims of the cancer of all worlds. We grew up as orphans, and were adopted by the family when they came to help. Mr. Gopherwood recognized our potential and brought us to Penacony. But I can't just stand by and watch Mr. Gopherwood become an enemy of the Harmony. I won't use my voice to support an evil cause. I won't step on that stage and sing. No matter who the traitor is, or what orders they give me. I won't let the Charmony Festival become an event that destroys Harmony itself, or the paradise in our dreams.
Indeed. For the paradise in our dreams. As the head of the Oak family, I'm responsible for ensuring Penacony's promising future. Robin and I will head into the sweet dream and confront the Dream Master. And if it turns out that the family has truly strayed from the Harmony, I'll fight alongside you. We'll put the Charmony Festival on hold and make sure Mr. Gopherwood pays for his blood debt.
The enemies you are about to face aren't like this old dog here who can barely even bark. Since our interests are aligned, why don't we team up? Maybe, just maybe, we'll have a shot at success.
Okay.
We've always been following in the footsteps of our nameless predecessors, and there's no reason to stop now.
Yeah, Lee Nameless won't back down from a challenge. Isn't that right, Mr. Trailblazer?
Enough to fear, no more, we'll win. Heroes never back down. Peace was never an option. Going up against the Dream Master, nah, I'll surrender. I don't know. Heroes are never back down, peace. I don't know. Let's try the third one.
Come on, don't crack jokes at such a serious moment.
Rest assured, sitting on the sidelines isn't in our nature. Mr. Sunday, Miss Robin, I'm willing to accompany you on behalf of the Astral Express. Having a third party present should help with negotiations, and could make all the difference if things get ugly.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank you all very much.
The Charmony Festival is about to start, and time is against us. We must hasten.
Everyone, okay. Let's gather over here. We still need to make some preparations. Oh. I may have been quick to step up to the plate, but confronting the Dream Master could be a very dangerous affair.
Uh-huh. Even you're saying that, Mr. Yang?
How powerful is that Dream Master?
He's the leader of the families of Penacony, and he has the entire power of the Harmony behind him. Not to mention the Stellaron in his possession.
Maybe you can just stay behind this time, Mr. Yang?
No, that won't do. Even if we count Robin as an ally, something felt off about Mr. Sunday just now.
Oh.
Although, I can't quite put my finger on it. I have to make sure he won't turn against us when things start to get dicey. You're still carrying the keepsake the IPC envoy gave you, right? May I borrow it for a moment?
Ah, the coin.
Huh. I knew it.
Like that. What do you need it for? I don't think.
As I suspected, this chip Aventurine gave to you is actually a miniature transmitter. If I'm right, he intends to use it to track your location or contact you when needed. As it so happens, this may actually be of some use in the current situation.
Aventurine? Is he still alive? And what does he have to do with our mission to confront the Dream Master?
Remember what I said earlier? Working with the IPC is a way to keep the family in check. If negotiations go south and the family show their true colors by going after the Stellaron, I'll use this transmitter to send a message to the IPC.
Oh.
It'll be just the opportunity the IPC ambassador was... The only question mark in all of this is Aventurine's current status. But the IPC is always listening, especially senior strategic investment department heads like him. Getting the message across shouldn't be a problem.
Good luck to you, Welt.
Well, you take care too. If anything goes wrong, don't worry about me. Just
what?
Make sure to seal the Stellaron.
What? Sounds like a life
spoken
of,
like a true hero.
Life or death, yeah. Life or death situation.
Even if the Dream Master is innocent, the family's corruption runs deep.
I won't make the same mistake in Kaelid. Let's wish him the best of luck.
Don't you have something else to tell us, Galak?
Why would you say so?
Before we departed, the conductor asked us to inquire about the three nameless in Penacony. We've already collected intel about Rosalina and Tiernan, so the only one left is Legwork, if I'm not mistaken. We've already met him somewhere, haven't we?
It's not enough to say meet, but the answer is pretty obvious. After all, I've hinted at it in quite an evident way. I've been watching over you ever since I received a reply from the Astral Express, and I've seen the great effort you all put into linking different realms together across the cosmos. And now, after getting this far all in one piece, you have truly proven yourselves. Miss Himiko, were you the one who repaired the Express and got it sailing through the cosmos again?
Yes.
And you two, young Nameless, you have very interesting life stories and extraordinary skills.
You're making me blush with all these flatteries, keep them coming. Of course, my reputation precedes me, believe in Galaxy. What? This two is not the option that I want to choose. You're making me blush. Of course, my reputation precedes me. whatever.
What? Hey, you can't just make up titles like that.
You're full of energy. Please send my regards to the conductor, Pom Pom. Please let them know that their friend had fond memories from his time aboard the Express, which he reminisced on every time he had a good drink. As for the last Nameless, he embarked, disembarked, and embarked again, traveling in a great circle, ending up back where he started. On his deathbed, he told me to find the Astral Express and deliver an invitation to the future Nameless. He left behind a special gift, a true legacy, something that belongs only to the successors of the Trailblaze. Come with me. Now is the time to reveal it.
So this means like what? Oh, Mateo. I'm so confused.
Back here again.
Sometimes I feel like you're still alive, old friend.
Like
you've still got so much to say and do. I've kept my promise, brought the future trailblazers you've waited so long for. I don't know why you were so obsessed with that train, but I remember your last words. Don't let us down, old man.
Cutscene?
What's happening?
Elevated? Oh my god. In between the two towers? They're going up. Why if it's like gonna fight a boss?
Go ahead. His resting place lies in the garden up ahead. The first and last nameless of Penacony. Mikhail Char Legward.
Ah, see, I told you. Oh, okay. Sorry. Still got a lot of treasures that I miss. I think the last one should be around here. Later we'll go there. There's a bird song. I'm scared. Okay, let's go. Beneath the sea surface of Memory Zone, in a garden closest to the full moon in the water, an elderly man rests on the recliner, developed in utter silence. The watchmaker, Mikhail Charles Legwork, has passed into that endless, timeless dream where no sound could ever awaken him.
Sure enough, the watchmaker is the third nameless. Even I could guess that one.
The legacy he left behind was a dream bubble. I believe inside that bubble, there's something that holds meaning only for the nameless. After all, when I checked its contents, I found nothing inside. Maybe some trailblaze runes? Even more mysterious than me.
Well, let's have a look.
As the word ceases, Himiko nods ever so slightly in your direction. You take a deep breath, steady your mind, and turn your gaze towards the watchmaker. Touch the dream bubble in Mikhail's hand. You press your hands against the dream bubble and thick, vicious memorial converge under strand. Then stretches outwards from your fingertips as if weaving a delicate web. It gently cradles your palm. A chill travels from your fingertips, carrying with it myriads of vibrant and intertwined memories, as experience would suggest. But this time, you see nothing at all. How could this be? Try focus, capture memory. Take a deep breath and try read dream bubble again. Try focus and capture the memories. Dream bubble is clear, extraordinary. Perhaps the approach was wrong, you think. Holding your breath and closing your eyes, with one knee on the ground, you press your forehead against the firm coated memorial. Before you do, there remains an abyss of darkness, no crimson sun descending upon snow-capped mountains, no gentle laughter, no twinkling stars, no echoes of swords clashing, and most of all, no trace of trailblaze. Indubitably, this is but an empty dream bubble.
Wait, what? Seriously? There's nothing inside this dream bubble? How could a dream bubble be empty?
Just as I suspected. That old man always had this strange belief in the nameless and the trailblaze. And I never understood where he got that confidence from. Especially since he never managed to get in touch with the Express while he was alive. I could never figure out what was going on in that old man's head. But this empty dream bubble is so typical of him. He was always full of weird fantasies and incomprehensible romanticism. That mischievous old man.
I didn't expect him to leave or anything. Okay.
Don't think that's the case, Gallagher. I'm sure Mikhail has left us the most precious thing of all.
Don't start getting all philosophical on.
Just as Mikhail believes in the nameless of the future, we unconditionally believe in the nameless of the past. How could they leave with regrets for the future when they were ready to dedicate their lives to there must be something contained in this dream bubble? It's just we haven't figured it out yet. You also have faith in the Watchmaker, don't you, Gallagher?
Well, I'm a follower of the Enigmata. My philosophy forbids me to have faith in anything. Okay. That's why I understand what faith means in the path of Trailblaze. And I also want to know what he left behind.
Can I borrow your pet?
Pet?
I need to make a trip back to Golden Hour and check something at the Dreamscape sales store. It's for Mikhail, and for the future of Penacony.
Okay. Oh, would you? Test is now.
Welcome to the Reverie Hotel. How may I help you?
Greetings. We're the Nameless from the Astral Express, and we'd like to check in.
The Astral Express?
But I...
Yes, my companion's already checked in. My name is Don Hum, and I believe my personal information is recorded in your system.
I see, but your companion said you wouldn't be coming due to a change of plans.
Now the plans have changed again.
And you are...
Me?
I'm Pom Pom.
Pom Pom.
A new Nameless.
New Nameless, who's also with the Astral Express.
He's my fellow trailblazer. We responded to the family's invitation before he boarded the Express, so he wasn't registered in your system. Is it possible to accommodate him as well?
Oh, I see. Another one of the Nameless had a similar situation. Seems like a lot of people are joining. Since there's a precedent, it shouldn't be a problem. Just give me a second to contact your companions. I'm sorry, dear guests, but it seems I'm unable to reach the other members of the Astral Express.
What do you mean by unable to reach?
My apologies. This is the first time I've encountered a situation like this. However, the system indicates that those guests are still in the Dreamscape.
How about this? Give me their room number, and we'll go check on them ourselves.
I'm afraid that's not possible. I need to verify both of your identities before I can share any guest information.
How about you just wake up someone? Let's say,
I'm sorry, but there are strict rules regarding forced awakening. It cannot be done without the proper clearance.
So nothing works, huh? What's your solution, then? Are you saying we sleep here? At the reception?
Please be patient. We need to contact your companions in order to confirm your identity.
And now it seems you need to confirm our identities before you can contact our companions.
Oh, fudge! Look, nothing personal, but if you can't handle this, go find someone else who can. Okay.
Please calm down, dear guests. I do recall that Mr. Sunday, the Oak family head, personally handled this issue earlier. Oh, please wait a moment while I contact him.
You can't contact him also.
I don't think she's trying to give us a hard time. She really just doesn't know what to do.
I have a bad feeling about this. You tried to contact him on the express earlier, but they didn't respond.
Something doesn't seem right. I need to leave for a moment. You can stay here with the receptionist.
Sure thing. Just don't keep me waiting forever. Don Hung seems pretty worried about his companions. I should give him some space. Stressing out about it won't help anything.
Broken arrow. Oh my god, can I shoot anyone here?
Locked and loaded.
Okay. Ask around in the lobby for information while waiting for Don Hung. Okay.
The Charmany Festival is about to start! I'm so excited!
Hey! You guys here for the Charmany Festival too?
Well, I didn't come all the way here specially for the festival. Honestly, I don't really even know what it's about, but I heard it's a lot of fun!
Well, back in my home world, Anaria, we have festivals like that all the time. My dad threw me a birthday party one time that was just as extravagant as the Charmany Festival.
Oh, come on! The Charmany Festival is a once in an amber era event! How can a birthday party compare?
Well, you never know, right? Maybe on her world, birthday's only... Anyway, let's forget about that. Have you heard about the, unsettling things happening in the Dreamscape?
Unsettling things? What could possibly go wrong? It better not ruin the Charmany Festival! I've been looking forward to-
Relax. With a big event like this, there's bound to be lots of gossip and rumors. Don't worry. If anything does happen...
Oh, that's a
relief.
I didn't come all this way to see the festival go down the drain. Well, looks like I won't get any fudging clues out of these two. They're clueless.
Greetings. I'm Cody of the Bloodhound family, head of security for the hotel. How may I assist you?
Hello. So, there's something I wanted to ask about. I've been hearing some unsettling rumors about certain incidents that might affect the Charmony Festival. Do you think there's anything to be worried about? I traveled all the way from the Hayai Federation.
Hayai.
I don't want my trip to be ruined.
What do you mean?
Wait. You haven't heard.
I'm not sure where you heard those rumors, but they're completely baseless. I can assure you, as a representative of the Bloodhound family, okay, that everything is going smoothly for the Charmony Festival. At present, all of the families are focused on making sure the festival starts on time. Even the Dream Master himself has arrived. So don't worry, your trip won't be in vain.
She doesn't appear to be acting. So, it seems that even the hotel staff are out of the loop. Back already?
Hasn't she returned yet?
Nope. I'm starting to wonder. Sending her to contact Sunday was good. Neither the staff nor the guests seem to know anything about what's happening in the Dreamscape. And wherever we go, all we see is people enjoying themselves.
Definitely not a good time.
I agree. Another unusual thing is that the Oak family is supposed to be in charge of organizing the council and managing everything inside and outside the Dreamscape. I walked around the hotel, but didn't meet a single member of the Oak family. On such an important...
Well, I'll be forked. If I remember correctly, the head of the Oak family is that Sunday guy.
We shouldn't linger here too long. Let's go back to the Express for now.
Not so fast. Have you ever robbed the IPC, bro?
If you run away now,
everyone will be chasing after you.
Are you suggesting we sit here and do nothing?
I wouldn't say do nothing, but let's stay put for now. Even if the family has ulterior motives, they couldn't have anticipated us showing up here. We're the surprise factor for them. They don't want to attract unwanted attention from certain outsiders, so they won't do anything reckless. See? The IPC lackeys are keeping a close eye on this hotel.
If I were a family member, I'd find an official excuse and keep the surprise factors here. If we just wait here, that would be like walking into their trap.
Of course, we don't need to walk into their trap. I gave a backup plan to the memo keeper. If it turns out we won't be allowed to enter the Dreamscape, she'll order a drink for me in the VIP lounge at the hotel. In reality...
a secret signal.
That's right.
Oh, a concrete object can indeed help the memo keeper establish a connection with you. But Boothill, if you have more backup plans in the future, I hope you'll let me know in advance.
Okay.
I'm sorry. But it's one of my quirks. I have too many unreliable friends. And if I reveal that I have backup plans, things can go awry.
Awry.
And that would leave all backup plans completely useless.
How do we get into the VIP lounge?
This is where my street smarts come into play.
I have to talk to him.
You're the lobby manager.
Yes, I am. How may I assist?
We're the Nameless from the Astral Express. We wanted to check in, but there's something wrong with your system. The lady at the front desk said she would contact the manager, but now she's nowhere to be found. We've been waiting here forever, without any food or water. What the fork, man? Is this how the family treats its guests?
Okay.
Is this your idea of street smarts? Starting an altercation?
It's called standing up for your right.
I apologize for the inconvenience. Please wait while we try to contact Mr. Sunday. I'll arrange two premium seats in the VIP lounge so you can rest there while you wait.
See? Just like that.
Just don't call yourself Nameless.
Okay.
Wow, this bar is something else. Certainly worthy of the planet of festivities.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening.
Hey, I have an order for a bottle of Hasdana's White Oak. Can you help us find it?
Hasdana's White Oak? I think there might be a misunderstanding. We don't serve that here.
Oh, no way. Are you sure you're not mistaken?
If someone had reserved such a beverage, I would definitely remember it. It sells for hundreds of thousands of credits per bottle, after all. I couldn't afford to cover for such an item if it were broken or locked.
That's strange. Well, could it be that the memo keeper couldn't afford it?
Then what should we do now?
No need to rush. Well, let's grab some drinks first. Maybe I arrived too early and he hasn't come yet. Let's see what kind of juice malts you all have here. Well, Give me a glass of Heenum Valley, 40 years.
What's
I'll
that?
I'll have a neat. No wine.
Well, that's the most expensive one on the list. You have a taste for the finer things.
It's on the house, anyway.
What can I get for you?
Anything you recommend, Dis.
Then I would recommend today's special.
Glass Village.
It's classic Soul Glad mixed with Laboon juice. It's refreshing and suits your cool demeanor. Just 1 minute.
Laboon juice.
Ah, this flavor. Dynamite barbecue with rocket fuel. Ooh, really hits the spot. Truly the finest sherry cask aged malt juice in the cosmos.
Dynamite barbecue with rocket fuel. Is that really something that humans enjoy?
Hey, this guy doesn't know anything at all.
As long as you're satisfied, dear guests, please enjoy.
Let's give the memo keeper another half system hour. If she doesn't show up, we'll need to come up with a new plan. In the meantime, let's take stock of the situation. What do you think?
The situation is unclear. Something must have happened on the planet of festivities, but the public is unaware of it. Someone in a position of power within the family must be covering it up. It's unusual for the followers of the Harmony to invite other factions, let alone the IPC and the Masked Fools. If what you said about the Emanator of the Nihility is true, the situation in Penacony is a little complicated, to say the least.
Actually, there's something else I'm concerned about.
Regarding the Acheron.
As you know, the faction that follows the path of the Hunt are some of the most dangerous bulks in the cosmos to mess with. Who in the right mind would impersonate the Xianzhou Alliance or the Galaxy Rangers? It's like asking for a death wish. Isn't there a saying among the Xianzhou people that the Rainbow Set lets their Lux Arrow do all the beating?
Talking. Do all the talking.
Well, you know what I mean. Even though the Galaxy Rangers have been out of sight for years, we've been keeping an eye on this region. Even the dumbest criminals know better than to mess with the Annihilation Gang, much less the Rangers. But that Acheron lady, she doesn't seem like a lunatic at all. On the contrary, she's highly logical and organized. She knows exactly when to hold back and when to strike without mercy.
And do you believe that someone like her would have an ulterior motive for impersonating a Galaxy Ranger?
I'm not entirely sure. I do have my suspicions. Maybe she knows a Galaxy Ranger, or perhaps she's trying to lure us out for some reason, which I can't figure out.
Anyway, what worries me more are the anomalies within the family. They've summoned followers from various paths for the festival. No matter how generous such a gesture is, this move seems highly unusual, unless the invitations weren't sent by them. If that's the case, it's even more intriguing that the family insists on organizing the Charmony Festival, despite the chaos.
Maybe it's Shi Pei the Harmony pulling the strings. You find it beyond human understanding because it wasn't arranged by humans at all. People do stupid things out of irrational impulses.
They abandon the principle when the self-interest involved. They believe in things they know they shouldn't.
Believe in things they know they shouldn't.
They even break their own rules.
But eons don't. They stick to their determined path and never turn back, even if they reach a dead end.
You think Shi Pei's will is behind all this?
It may not necessarily be Shi Pei.
Definitely some higher entity.
There's definitely some higher entity involved.
It's not pessimistic.
I know it may sound pessimistic.
But if human free will were reliable.
It's much simpler when you boil it down to the eons and paths. Like how Lan always follows the path of the Hunt, or how the Express stays true to the Trailblaze despite...
But in my opinion, Akavili's fall holds significance for the Nameless.
Oh. So you're saying the Nameless now have to take responsibility for their own choices because their absolutely right leader is gone?
Exactly. I believe the purpose of the journey isn't just about following a path that's always considered absolutely right. It's more about doing your best to choose the right path for yourself among countless possibilities, even with limited insight and judgment.
I don't know what you've been through, but I agree that people must take responsibility for their choices. That's why the Galaxy Rangers need to uncover the imposter. Figure out.
Talk a lot.
Just in case, I have a backup plan if the memo keeper doesn't show up.
This is my final backup plan.
You sure have a lot of cards up your sleeve.
Well, going back to my old career would make things a lot easier. By the way, when you were walking around the hotel, did you happen to see any important looking guests?
What's your plan?
It's simple. We just grab some hostages and use them as bargaining chips with the family. Or maybe we can even take their identities.
No need for that. Mm-hmm. We'll return to the Express now.
Wait. Are you getting scared? Draw your weapon. Let's make a big scene.
Oh,
are you leaving, esteemed guests? Would you like to cancel that Asdana's White Oak you just ordered?
Huh? As dawn as white oak. But
oh, someone just ordered already. Yeah.
Looks like you are a bit intoxicated, esteemed guests.
You ordered
a bottle of As Dawn as White Oak just a moment ago.
Hmm. Looks like your memo keeper friend has finally arrived.
Without appearing.
Oh, right. Sorry, my memory's not the best. You know,
too many modifications and all. Let me check.
Anyway, let me check. Well, fork me. It's As Dawn as White Oak, all right. And there's a note. I'll be waiting for you on the Astral Express.
No mistake. That's her message to you. She knew the hotel wasn't safe, so she suggested we find another place.
Well, looks like we took a detour, but now it's back to the Astral Express. So,
okay, let's go.
You're back? Two guests just boarded saying they were looking for Boot Hill.
What?
So I told them to wait in the parlor car.
Two guests?
Oh, just in
two guests?
Yeah.
Yeah, or two. Look, we welcome all passengers on the Astral Express, but sneaking in like that, you have no regard for etiquette.
My apologies, conductor. It was an oversight on my part. I assumed you were already acquainted with the garden.
Yeah.
Given the chaotic situation in Panacone, the Nameless are the only ones we can truly trust right now.
You are the memo keeper.
Pleased to meet you, Don Hung. I've seen you in others' memories. And as for Boot Hill, this is our first face-to-face meeting.
I hope you enjoyed that bottle
of Astana's White Oak. You sure have a refined taste.
Finally, Memo Keeper. Well, let's cut to the chase. Spill everything you know.
That's precisely what I intend to do. But before that, please allow me to introduce myself.
My name is Black Swan.
My name is Black Swan.
Acheron.
And I serve the Garden of Recollection as a Memo Keeper. As for Acheron's story, I'm sure she knows it better than I do.
Greetings. I'm Acheron.
What? You Garden of Recollection shirtbag! You betrayed me!
I apologize, but she did that at my request. Due to certain reasons, I have been exiled by the family. Thankfully, this memo keeper came to my aid and helped me escape their surveillance unnoticed.
To be honest, it was more like stalking than helping. And the process was far from unnoticed. But we did escape.
I asked her to guide me to a place beyond the family's reach and to contact a few trustworthy individuals, namely all of you.
Trustworthy? Son of a nice lady, you think I'm dumb or something? How about this? I'll put a few bullet holes in your head and see what secrets spill out. Then, we can talk about trust.
It doesn't have to be like that. I'm willing to answer all your questions, but not right now. If my cover hadn't been blown, we might have had more time, but at the moment, we don't have any other options.
No other options? What do you mean?
This is the only way I can ensure everyone's safety. I kindly request an immediate warp jump out of the Astana star system.
What? Our Astana star system?
This passenger is requesting...
As far as I can tell, she's not a threat and seems to be telling the truth.
Right, something is about to explode.
I've briefly traveled with your companions and know their whereabouts, Don Hung. Please rest assured, your nameless companions are safe, but they need our help. As for Boot Hill, you may have guessed. I've been waiting for you. Galaxy Rangers are known for their elusive nature and limited contact with each other. So this was the only way I could reach out to you.
Okay.
Only by doing this can I find a true Galaxy Ranger and fulfill a long-standing promise.
Okay.
To return his relics to their rightful owner.
Relics? His relics?
Someone once told me that every rainfall is like a gift from the heavens, a sign of their mercy upon the world. Raindrops are said to be the tears of the gods, shed in response to the sorrows of the world.
Oh.
Their constant pouring is a reminder that the gods haven't abandoned us yet. So, how long has this rain been going on for?
I used to believe, just like you, that it would eventually stop.
Your decade passed.
And decades passed. And in the end, such hope faded away before the rain did. Looks like the god you mentioned doesn't exist after all.
As he spoke, the old man's gaze remained fixed on the distance. Amidst the fine drizzle of black rain, countless shadowy hands emerged from the sea, shrouded in an ethereal mist, reaching out towards the skies one by one.
Well,
let me share a story with you.
Mortals who walk the paths
are like sailors on a vast ocean. Leaving behind a trail that creates countless ripples of possibilities. These reapers last longer than the fleeting lifespan of humans.
And for some,
their presence leaves such a strong mark that it reflected in the waves.
Like
the shadow
the
of the
oceans. Sinthirsters.
Sinthirsters.
The obsessions of the path striders.
They emerge from the depths of IX. Seeing themselves as masters.
As masters of their own destiny. Unknowingly repeated the actions of their past lives. They emerge from the nihility and head toward it, leading purposeless lives.
These hollow phantoms.
They were once my dear companions.
Oh.
A group of galaxy rangers.
Are you watching over them?
Watching over them? No. I'm guiding them toward transcendence. It was a brutal war. A crusade that shook the universe.
The universe witnessed the fall of Zulo, the Lord Ravager.
The fall of Zulo, the
Lord
Ravager.
At a price. A price that hefty. Only those who were there still remember.
The unwavering determination of the hunt followers
persists even in death. So someone must guide these lost souls to their life beyond. They were heroes in their time, and they shouldn't be reduced to mere puppets of inhibility.
As for me,
I've suffered many losses on the battlefield to advance any further. That makes me the most fitting person to carry out this task.
But you know, these Sinthirsters, they're not who they used to be.
Does this seem pointless to you? Well, some tasks have to be done, even if they are pointless.
I can help you.
For what?
For the meaning of the nihility. That's what I've been seeking.
I see. After all, this realm is off limits to ordinary souls, right? Thank you, stranger. I wish that you find what you seek.
Before we part ways, I have one more question. It is true that their actions and even their entire lives may seem pointless from our perspective. But if, and it's just an if this is what the departed ones expected, should we try to change it?
A good question, and a profound one.
I don't know the answer.
What I do know is that one day, I too will pass away. And when I bid farewell to this world, someone will stand at my grave and place a bouquet of flowers on it.
Who is that uncle? The old grandpa. Nice system hour before the Chamonix Fest.
When I appeared as a child, my speech, mindset, and soul reflected immaturity as I grew into adulthood. I left behind my childlike side.
I humbly request your blessings, esteemed advocate of Shipe.
Come to me, my kinship. I have sought their presence with us.
As you wish. I have faithfully served the Alfalfa family for nearly a decade, promoting the path of the harmony to the best of my ability. However, I made a mistake yesterday. While I was preparing dinner for the family head, I accidentally dropped a prepared dish on the floor out of laziness. I lied and claimed that everything was ready. Although the head has dismissed me as punishment, it has been tough to sleep with the guilt still gnawing at me, as I worry that the seeds of evilness may have taken root in my soul. So, I confess to you now, to seek atonement for my sin.
Do you sincerely repent and vow to change your ways?
Yes.
Have you examined your soul and confessed all your sins?
Oh, yes.
Are you willing to accept the process of atonement? Very well. Show your dedication and goodwill to the family, and you shall be reinstated among them.
Now.
Now.
Please live in peace.
Oh, praise Shipe. And thank you, esteemed advocate.
Next.
I wholeheartedly confess to you. Please, pardon my sins.
Rest assured, I have implored their presence to be with us. As long as you are sincere, absolution will be granted.
Oh, great. You know, I arrived in Paniconi as a stowaway. I sold everything to get a ticket. My house, my land, and
my two children.
I see.
My children were starving, and I hope they'd have a chance at survival if they became slaves here. If I can strike it rich here, I'll lift them out of that situation and give them the life they deserve. But the Bloodhound family got wind of it. They're on my tail, hunting me down. I thought I could bring my kids here. It was all my fault.
The family is ready to forgive all sinners. I'll ask the Bloodhound family to cease their pursuit. You don't need to live in fear anymore.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
I wrote my hardest to redeem my children and make them a part of the family.
Make them part of the family.
Next, please.
Hey, long time no see, Mr. Sunday. The most esteemed individual in Penacony, and the next leader of the Oak family.
I have sought their presence with us. Let us proceed.
Sure. Let's just get this over with.
I have sinned. Please forgive me.
I have sinned. Please forgive me.
I wasted
half a pizza at breakfast and a bottle of soul blood. That's it. Nothing more. Can we wrap this up? Huh. I've got a robo-ball game to catch, you know?
Do you seek to atone for your sins through good deeds?
My sins? I'm starting to sound like a saint, huh? Let me tell you something. Neither the family nor you have the right to judge me.
Yeah, what you came here for?
You think nobody knows what your precious family has done? About the Watchmaker? Huh? Don't kid yourself, Featherbrain. Those dream chasers might be fooled by your act, but don't fool yourself. Before you start spouting off your holy verses, answer me this. Where does the power of the Oak family come from?
And your power. What makes you think you can sit there all high and mighty, looking down at everyone else?
Well, I've spent enough time in confession today to enter the Harmony's paradise, right? Then I'll take my leave. Good luck with your election, and don't make me regret my investments in you.
Oh, revered triple-faced soul. Hear my doubts. Who can judge the strong when their power hides their crimes? Who can vouch for the weak when they will pay any price to survive? Who can comfort the purest souls when even they get led astray? If the strong defending the weak is truly the foundation of paradise, then who is responsible for the suffering and anguish in this wretched world?
Brother? Brother, are you all right?
I'm fine. I've been working long hours, and I just made a trip to Dreamflux Reef and back. So, I'm a bit out of sorts. But it'll all be over before we know it.
You've been working non-stop on the Charmany Festival, Mr. Sunday, and no one could have predicted this incident. Even if the Stellaron does pose a grave threat, I still feel sorry for all the trouble we've caused you.
No need to worry about troubling anyone. The Charmany Festival was meant to spread joy and harmony across the cosmos.
Now we know the truth. I'm afraid that we'll have to cancel it.
It has always been our wish to make everyone happy, so we'll do our best to explain everything to the Dream Master. Even if the negotiation does not go smoothly.
I refuse to go on stage.
I'll refuse to go on stage.
Without a Courtmaster, the Harmonious Choir would not arrive. Okay.
And the Charmany Festival would be just a grand performance, and nothing more.
I'm relieved to see your determination. You know, since arriving in Penacony, we haven't had any contact with this Dream Master himself. I'd heard of the heads of the five major lineages, but the Dream Master is a mystery to me.
The Dream Master rarely grants an audience, even for us. But given the urgency of the situation, he's agreed to meet us in person.
Perhaps he'll be the first guest to meet the Dream Master in years, Mr. Yang.
Let's hope we can reach a consensus that satisfies...
Indeed. Let us hope so.
It's about time. We'll have to get ready for the meeting. I apologize for any inconvenience caused by the urgency.
Don't worry. I'll be waiting here.
Oh dear.
Oh dear.
Mr. Sunday! Oh. Hey! Come over here!
Looks like someone needs help. Let's go check it out.
This guy.
Oh, Mr. Sunday. Hey there! Okay, see the moon in the sky? It's about the size of the cap on my Soul Glad box. If I just reached out my hand, I could grab the moon, couldn't I?
The moon? You mean the Grand Theater?
Yeah. Look at me. I've been away from home for too long. I must be missing that moon. But it's no big deal. The Grand Theater here looks much better than the moon back home. It's just magnificent. They told me not to sell everything I had just to come to Penacony. How short-sighted.
Selling everything you had? Why would you go to such lengths?
Why? Can't you see? Life back home is miserable. It's not really living at all. It's better to be here at Penacony. No, pain, no worries about tomorrow, just sweet dreams. You can do whatever you want. That's what I call living. Yeah.
Is this truly living?
Huh? What did you say, young lady? I didn't quite catch that.
Oh, it's nothing, sir. You see, the traffic on Glocks Avenue can be dangerous. How about I ask a Bloodhound family member to escort you to Idine Park over there, so you can continue enjoying your sweet dream?
Oh, yeah, that's a great idea.
Wow.
No wonder you're the leader of the sweet dream. You're totally a lifesaver. See you around, Mr. Sunday, and it was nice chatting with you.
What's up, sister?
This is the land of the dreams. But why do they live like that? The man we ran into, he doesn't seem happy at all. Even though sweet dreams are nice, they're just illusions. But for him, they're the only way to survive, even if it means giving up on reality. That's not really living at all.
I suppose you have a point. But, in my opinion, that's how most people live their lives.
Why do you say that?
You think that man is not actually living, but that's not quite accurate. Even without Penacony, people create their own illusions called self-value. People believe they have a predetermined value to fulfill. Gaining value means gaining power, and those deemed worthless are seen as the weak. However, value doesn't come out of thin air, and there's a limit to it. To accumulate value, people have to take from others, so the weak get exploited and oppressed.
Are you suggesting that this is not how things should be?
Exactly. But, ironically, people don't think there's anything wrong with it.
Because they uphold
the illusory notion of self-value. And even the weak believe in it. The survival of the fittest. That's where all the tragedies in the world come from. People come to the sweet dream in Penacony to escape from that reality and find solace. No tragedies exist here. Only happiness. Although in its nascent form. Isn't that the same paradise we yearn for in our dreams?
Perhaps that man is just an exception. Let's not jump to conclusions. We should experience the dreamscape ourselves. Just as I did at Dreamflux Re.
Yes. Seeing is believing. I'll accompany you. The Dream Master hasn't shown up yet, so we have some time.
Okay.
Glad to meet you again, Robin. How are the preparations for the Charmony Festival coming along? We're all so excited.
It's going smoothly. Thanks for making the trip to join the fest.
You're too kind, Robin. It's a pleasure to have guests from all over the universe celebrating day.
I can't stand being lonely or bored, so this Jubilant Dreamscape is perfect for me.
But if this went on forever, would it get boring too?
Nah, not at all. Who would get tired of having so much fun?
Really?
Every day, you get to wear fancy clothes, explore all sorts of dream bubbles, indulge in delicious food without gaining weight, and you never get old or sick. As long as you can afford a room, this place is the ultimate paradise.
Okay.
But you know that only a few things can be brought back from the dreamscape to reality, right?
That's exactly why I don't plan on bringing anything back. Just enjoying the dream itself is good enough for me. I'm not one of those long-living species. I only have around 60 or 70 years in this lifetime, and there's so much to worry about. Being happy here is pure. Only in this sweet dream can I truly feel like I'm in control of my life and fate. Who would want to go back to reality after experiencing this bliss?
Okay.
I see.
I genuinely
wish you all the happiness in the world.
And I wish you a fantastic performance, Robin! I'm off to the Blue Hour for the ball. See you later.
Okay.
Seems like that guest's perspective didn't resonate with you either.
She had a valid point. And I could sense her genuine happiness. It's just that...
What you're trying to say is, she thinks she's in control of her life. But in reality, she's just escaping from reality and seeking solace in this sweet dream.
Once she steps out of this sanctuary, everything will be lost.
Well, she did make mention of being able to afford a room. Didn't she?
However,
paradise.
The paradise in our dreams.
It doesn't have to.
No. And the paradise we yearn for shouldn't be just a fleeting dream either. The scenery in this dreamscape is truly breathtaking, isn't it?
Oh,
Robin, can't believe I'm meeting you in person here. What an honor. You're right. Even though time stands still in this dreamscape, it always feels fresh. I find something new every time.
A philosophical mind. I hope I'm not intruding.
Oh, not at all. With little time left, I yearn for meaningful conversations. Especially with someone as esteemed as you. Do you mind if we chat?
It's my pleasure. No need to be formal. Just speak your mind. You said, with little time left. Please, forgive me for being blunt. But is that why you came to Penacony?
Yeah. I was part of a war, and while escaping from the Sarkozyan mothership, I got exposed to some radioactive materials.
Oh.
And then, all my comrades died, and my hometown was wiped out by neutron bombardments. I couldn't bear to live with everything I knew gone.
That's when I heard about the possible solution here,
so...
How heart-wrenching.
I hope the family has been able to help you.
They have, and I'm truly grateful for that.
They provided, me with a comfortable room, the most advanced life support devices
in the cosmos, and a stellar team of caregivers. My physical body is now in the dream pool, sustained by life support. The me you see here is whole, rational, and no different from any other person. But I can't say the same for the me in the hotel room. My true appearance. Huh? I hope you never have to witness it, Robin.
Oh.
So, you'll be living forever in this dreamscape.
Just being able to live at all is good enough for me. Whether it's in this dreamscape or not, well, I don't really have much say in the matter. My world has been torn apart, and my life could end any second. So, even if this whole place is an illusion, it's still my paradise.
I treasure every moment I spend here. How I envy those everlasting things. Oh.
That old man's story. It's so tragic.
Fortunately,
this sweet dream gives him joyful memories to hold on to
for the rest of his
life.
That's precisely why this sweet dream in Penacony exists.
However, even this sweet dream has its limitations. While it provides solace to the disillusioned,
it can't completely eliminate pain
in reality.
There will be a way out. Penacony is already on the right track.
Are you sure? Are you just trying to brainwash me?
Look what we have here. A lovely young lady.
Sparkle!
Wait, is that me? Brother, what a surprise to see you again.
Show yourself. Your trick won't work on us.
I've heard that a skilled mass fool received an invitation too. That must be you, right? Did you enjoy yourself?
Barely. The people here are way too gullible. A little bait is all it takes for them to bite. And they run away at the slightest hint of danger. In other words, they're naive and cowardly.
Now that you've had your fill, it'd be wise to leave before it's too late. The music of the harmony doesn't tolerate discord.
What? Now that you have the real Robin, I'm useless? Oh, how disheartening. I've done so much for the family. You should be thanking me, because if it weren't for me cleaning up this mess, Penacony would still be in shambles. Don't you?
That was a personal request from the head of the Iris family, and it has nothing to do with us. Step aside and stop causing trouble for the Charmony Festival.
The Charmony Festival? You think you can scare me? You think I've no idea what you're planning? I don't care what you're thinking, chicken wing boy.
I'm pretty sure our lovely Robin will appear on stage. After all,
you're well aware of what sorry state this dreamscape is in under the banner of harmony. Penacony, the land of the dreams. Is this truly the paradise you desire?
Stop it.
What's the rush, chicken wing boy?
Our paradise is none of your concern, masked fool. Leave now, or the family won't tolerate you anymore.
All right. I'll go. But Robin, I suggest you seriously consider this. Do you really believe those living in dreams can escape pain and find true happiness? Well, I've done my part, and now I'm simply waiting for the fireworks to begin. Here, the last two gifts for both of you. And don't lose them. If by some unfortunate chance the Charmony Festival starts against all odds, remember to use them during the show. And it'll be thrilling. Bang!
I wonder, is she saving everyone or is she trying to kill everyone? That's the question.
I heard a raven calling in the distance. It seems the Dream Master will arrive soon. Let's wait here for the Dream Master to arrive.
Okay. By the way, brother, I heard you no longer have a sweet tooth. Back when we were kids, you used to steal my dessert. Seems like a lot has changed during my absence. What exactly happened?
Well, someone has to stay awake even in this sweet dream.
But that someone doesn't have to be you, or anyone in particular. You're carrying too much on your shoulders, brother. The paradise in our dreams. It shouldn't be like this. Hanakoni is nothing more than a dream. It can't erase the worries and pain of reality, or bring true happiness. It only offers an escape from reality. Nothing more.
Remember the old man we met earlier? Without this dream, he might have completely lost himself.
That might be true, but even without Hanakoni, he could have chosen another path. As far as I know, the Intelligentsia Guild has been promoting their rehabilitation techniques for a long time now. That path may have been more ordinary and challenging. But now, he is receiving hospice care in a comatose state, and his fate is sealed. Is Hanakoni granting these people a future? Or is it taking it away from them?
Well, don't forget this. Not everyone really has a future. The future for humanity is like the sky for birds. People mistakenly believe that flight is inherent to birds because they've never witnessed those birds crashing to their death. Do you remember how we took in that little Charmony dove when we were young?
Yeah, we took care of it. Provided food and water, groomed its feathers. And later, when I decided to leave Hanakoni, I opened the cage and set it free.
Well, I didn't mention what happened to it in my letters because I didn't want to upset you. Shortly after you left, it crashed to its death right in front of your window.
I had surmised as much. I knew you wouldn't have avoided mentioning the bird for no reason. Despite that unfortunate outcome, I still believe it was the right decision. Birds aren't meant to spend their lives in cages. They belong in the sky, even if they can't fly.
But here's the thing. If there are birds in this world that can never fly, can we really assert that they belong in the sky?
Are you implying that the same goes for humans too?
Let's take the Astral Express as an example. The Nameless made tremendous efforts to bridge worlds, gaining fame across the universe. However, only a few extraordinary individuals can endure such a perilous journey. That's because the pursuit of the Trailblaze exceeds the capabilities of ordinary humans. Otherwise, why would this path be filled with broken rails, an abandoned express, and even a fallen Eon?
That's just sophistry. If that were true, then only the powerful would have the right to determine the future.
Unfortunately, that's exactly what happens. Another name for the future is self-value. While this world has its fair share of heroes who inspire people and garner admiration for their heroic deeds, the majority of ordinary people will never become heroes in their lifetime.
Why this topic becomes so deep and so hard to talk about, I feel like. At first, it's just talk about the life and death. It's like some people, when they are really, very sick or very ill, when they have, like, for example, cancer, and then they're at their final stage, sometimes the patient will just wish they can just die and rest in peace instead of keep battling because it's too tired and too struggling. And I don't object that decision. It's like the same situation mentioned in this game. And sometimes some people will choose to fight for survival to win the battle, and they did. And sometimes it just like there's a very fine line and very low percentage of success. So there's not really a true answer to this kind of situations, and I can understand why Sunday say sometimes, like, it's not everyone can be a hero. Sometimes it just also depends on the ability or the talent or some gifted, born with it stuff, or a lot of training.
Some are born weak and vulnerable. Some find themselves trapped in unfortunate circumstances. Some fall victim to malice and cowardice. When it comes to survival, everyone is equal. And the weak can only watch as their value gets constantly diminished by external forces.
It sounds so sad.
That's why we should care for the weak and support them as if their suffering were our own. That's what the Odes of Harmony have always taught us.
While the Harmony holds noble aspirations, the strong will always be strong, and the weak will always be weak. Even in this carefree dream. Human nature contains greatness, but it also harbors inherent weaknesses that can't be eradicated. In the end, if people can't even secure their own survival, they won't care about the illusory future of equality. As long as the law of survival of the fittest prevails, there will always be fledglings crashing to their death.
But if people don't live for the future, do they merely exist for survival? If even you, my brother, don't believe that the Harmony will save the weak, then which eon can make our dreams come true?
Oh dear.
People often forget that when the first bird took flight, the entire world envisioned a future where no more fledglings would ever crash to their death.
Are you reading, sister? What are you reading?
Mr. Gopher Wood gave me a picture book. It's about the story of the harmonic strings. If I could become a chord master, I'd like to summon Dominicus, the harmonious choir. I want to sing with everyone and spread our wishes so that all can feel happiness and joy.
I see. Then I would summon the harmonious choir too.
Don't you have a wish of your own, brother?
Of course I do. It's just that it includes your wish and everyone else's. I long for a true paradise where everyone can find peace.
Then let's build a stage there and invite everyone to our performance so that both our wishes come true through the power of the harmonious choir.
It's a deal then.
Yeah, it's a deal. But
Maybe you'll have to become a star first.
To be the choir master? It's just a matter of
You're back sooner than I thought. Any results?
Yes. And now, it's up to us to forge ahead.
Since he's already carried out his last wish, my final mission is complete, but pardon me if I sound curt. It's good to have determination. The path Mikhail left for you is not an easy one to tread. Why else would he have chosen to sleep in solitude, staking everything on some nameless in the future? But you have the numbers, and in numbers comes strength. So that might just delay your inevitable.
Got any more encouraging words?
As I see it, relying on Welt's negotiations alone is far from enough. Regardless of whether the other party will be compliant, negotiating simply allows us to meet them as equals and won't grant us an upper hand. Hanakoni is our rival's home turf, and we already have very few chips left to play with. Rather than idly sit around while the family's got us blocked off, an offensive approach might be a wiser course of action. We're more familiar with the Stellaron's properties than most. And since it's the key to stabilizing the Sweet Dream, it's vital to the family's interests. By attacking their core interests, they're bound to retaliate hastily. And as the saying goes, haste makes waste.
That's right. As long as we pose a threat to the Stellaron, either with words or otherwise, we have a chance at gaining the upper hand. But the problem is, on the eve of the Charmony Festival opening, how exactly are we going to get close to the theater? Family security will be airtight. And if we brute force it, even if we succeed, it's too risky.
So, no one's gonna say anything? Then I'll raise my hand. I know the answer to this question.
You out of all people, of course. You do. I never doubt you have. Not like we have one more ace. And one more ace up, obviously, if time to. I don't know. Of course, I don't know, last one.
Why are you speaking like the general of the Law Fu? So, I heard that before the Charmony Festival begins, there'll be a pageant to kick off the festival. It's called the Soul Glad TM Festivity Auditions, or something, and it's going to be held in the moment of Scorch Sand. As long as we clinch the top spot, we'll be able to attain the title of Festive Superstar, and be able to personally bask in the graces of Miss Robin. Not that that's important. What's crucial is that we can enter the Grand Theater before the audience arrives.
So, how do we go about participating in these festivity auditions?
Why? We gotta do this singing stuff?
I've already procured special invite tickets from Miss Robin's fan club.
Oh, great.
To tell you the truth, I had been preparing to join the auditions all along. But now it looks like even if I scrape through, I probably still won't have the chance to shake Miss Robin.
So they're still running this thing, huh? It was originally just a publicity stunt, set up by Mikhail to drum up attention. But it looks like...
Who has the shot?
We'll follow Marge's plan. Mr. Gallagher, will you be joining us?
I'm afraid I won't have the time. As a virtual character...
I already completed my final mission. Whether Pentaconi can awaken from this dream...
Whether Pentaconi can awaken...
Should we ever cross paths again? I'd love for you to visit the Express.
Okay.
All right. I'll have to add to that databank of yours you've got on the Express.
And Miss Firefly, we thank you for all your support. We're faced with a formidable enemy. As long as the Astral Express and Stellaron Hunter's objectives are aligned, we're willing to cooperate with you.
We've already come this far together. I'd like to join you for the rest of your journey on Pentaconi.
Oh.
I'm pleased that we can finally fight shoulder to shoulder.
This is also the spirit of the Trailblaze. Now, everyone, let's prepare to move out.
Where should we go? I've been sitting here for so long. Now it's already 5:30.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Scorch Sand Hall. This is where challengers thrive. If you have dreams and the drive, dear friend, the next superstar of Pentaconi's Charmany Festival could be you.
Oh, wow, they've really outdone themselves. Oh, I'm starting to get excited.
Behold, here come four friends with spirit high and full of steel.
Is he talking about us?
Yes.
Yes, you! There's no doubt about it. I see you have all the potential of a superstar in you.
Excuse me, you four. What are you hoping to get out of all this?
As the last group of contestants, how confident are you in overcoming all of the challenges?
Would you be open to a brief exclusive interview with us? It'll be quick.
Your journey is long and fraught with peril, yet under a sky blanketed by banners, you by the crown.
The sword and rose! Protect the beauty! The beauty! The beauty!
A knight's head is hard as steel. Brother Lance's focus is stubborn as a heel. We don't all have to be winners. But if we don't have fun, we'd all be sinners.
People are pouring in. Kind of feels like all sorts of baddies are showing up. Let's get in there quickly and enter the competition.
Ladies and gentlemen, please make way.
Coming towards us now is one of Pentaconi's top 10 wealthiest tycoons.
Is it Aiden?
Allow me to introduce myself. Oh. I'm the director of Soul Glad's factory, Aiden Lina. My four friends, introduce yourselves to the audience across the cosmos.
Hello, everybody. I'm Himiko, a nameless from the Astral Express, and these are my companions.
Don't you guys need to hide your identities?
I can't hide it anyways. Pentaconi is plastered with our posters. And because the Astral Express is so well known, the family won't dare to make any rash moves.
Hello, I'm JGamer, and she's March 7. Yeah, we'll just say that.
Hello, everyone! I'm March 7. I'm an ordinary girl who loves adventure.
Hello, everyone. I'm Firefly. I am also a girl who enjoys adventures.
So it's a bunch of nameless guests. This final face-off is bound to be spectacular. Time is precious. My four friends, come with me.
Grab a bottle of Soul Glad and make your dreams a blast.
My God. This is another map? Oh my God.
Grab a bottle of Soul Glad.
Okay.
Mates, your arrival reminds me of the grand occasion when Pentaconi was first established. I was still a young, bright-eyed lad back then, lured here by the watchmaker's ads, full of zeal and ready to make my first fortune in life. Once, during a particularly grueling day, I passed out and was resuscitated by a drink from Mr. Sousa.
Okay.
That sweet taste has since been etched in my mind, And that was what drove me to create the Soul Glad that we all know and love today. The dream-chasing era was truly a wondrous time. Oh, I miss those days. And the Watchmaker. Scorched Sand Hall is my homage to that time of boundless possibilities. I wholeheartedly hope you make it to the finish and emerge as the next superstars of Pentacomb.
Now then, is anything you would like to say
is
before?
Is there anything you'd like to say?
Can we get the ball rolling already? Rest assured, we're gonna take an L in this, I can feel it. I don't know. Nah, we'll win. I guess it's just simply answering it.
That's the trailblazing spirit!
Hello, everyone! Next up, get ready for the Mega March 7th adventure, where I'm going to break the speedrun world...
Trailblazing into the uncharted and challenging the limits. That's Miss March 7th for you. How about Miss Firefly?
I hope that by the end of this journey,
everyone will have
achieved the outcome that they hope for.
Ah, a wonderful wish! Miss Himmett.
Safety first, everyone.
Simple words, but waiting for you are three stages, each connected to that era. The first two stages offer two distinct paths to choose from. And in the last stage, you will face off against a champion who has defended the title to this very
day.
Those are the rules. Simple. Everyone clear?
Can I just get it started? It's so talkative.
Everyone, as the Chimney Festival is drawing closer, we must reach the end as quickly as possible.
Oh my god.
Factoring in efficiency and safety, March and I haven't known Miss Firefly for too long and aren't overly familiar with her. It'd probably be
fine by me. All right.
Let's do this.
We'll split into the assigned groups then. Let's not.
I gotta jump on it. Ah, there's a bird. Okay, let me do that. Too many things.
Welcome to the first stage of Soul Glad Enterprises in the School of
Acting Challenge. You have to complete a performance. Three scripts.
Three scripts and move the panel judges. In the School of Action Challenge, you have to defeat three groups now. Make.
Pinball. Oh my god. What? What in the world? Acting challenge. Fantasia. It's the same, so whatever. I don't know what I'm thinking at.
The stage of dreams for those who dare to dream. Welcome to the School of Acting Stage.
What am I doing?
Competitors, allow me to introduce the rules of this challenge to you. There are three stages up ahead. On each, you will find an outline of a script. These three scripts were written by the legendary filmmaker, the Watchmaker, and depict various stories from Pentacone's era. Your task is to bring those moments to life.
Okay.
Find the right words and act convincingly to make the judges feel the script's intended emotion. Also, a bit of trivia. The record score for this stage is held by a participant with fiery red hair. His exceptional performance brought even the strictest judge to tears.
Red hair guy? Is that the Argenti?
We are running out of time. Quietly. Quietly.
Oh, just take a look at this pair. Such star quality. Since you come as a pair, I'll prep a two-person scene for you. You two, are you...
I don't know what I'm
envision
doing.
Envision that you both, driven by the spirit of exploration, are arriving at the land of dreams that is Pentacone for the first time. But instead of lush lands, you find yourselves amidst swirling sands and desolation. Far from the pair, you're driving an old clunker through the wilderness of the dreamscape. Braving the cold wind, choking on the dust, and suddenly, a fierce now, Mr. Greyhair.
Well,
what line would you deliver to express your dis-
Grey, I love living in this wild side. British creature. Quick, let's run it over. What a tarnation in this hellhole. The Watchmaker is a big fat liar, I guess.
Very good. Now, though you're disappointed, your screen partner is conversely very enthusiastic. Now,
this is great. I love living Wildside.
Very good. Very intense. And then we cut to the story's next scene.
You find a job mending
the rails. But the days are long, and your endurance can't keep up.
If I collapse,
finally collapse suddenly. Sweet rain falls from the sky, wet in your lips. Now, Mr. Greyhair.
Mr. Greyhair. Ooh, wee, Pentaconi, my Pentaconi, truly a bound opinion. Just let me die a dozen instead. Perhaps we're never meant to succeed. I don't know. It's really bound with opportunities, I guess. Did I answer wrong?
But at this moment, your partner yet gazes into the sky, both her eyes closed. The raindrops fall, blurring her vision, and she tragically says,
Perhaps we were never meant to succeed, right?
I don't know.
Fantastic! Both of you have an incredibly solid foundation in dialogue delivery. However, lines aren't everything in a performance. Up next, you'll be challenged with a...
I hope these tests won't take too long.
What?
Here, you two are required to skillfully utilize body language to portray the story context I've laid out for you, picking up from where we left off. A heavy downpour saves you both stranded in the desert. This rain quenches the anger in your heart. You look to your companion, now completely devoid of fighting spirit, wanting to comfort her. At this moment, what should you do to make her laugh?
Tell that, Joe, I guess. I don't know.
The test now is about body language. I don't think dialogue is allowed here.
Okay. Alright.
You seriously think that would make someone laugh?
What? Right in the sand.
What?
Right answer. Your companion sees you rolling about in the sand and thinks about the arduous obstacles along this journey. She can't help but let loose a laugh, rekindling hope in her.
I'm gonna get back on my feet and keep moving forward.
A tug at the heartstrings! The story continues to develop. The heavy rain leads you both to sense a business opportunity, so you start venturing into the umbrella industry. But just as the business begins to pick up, competitors start flooding the market with low-priced goods. Squeak! You have no choice. The goods you stockpiled at high prices have to be sold at a loss.
This is pretty self-destructive.
This is a pretty self-destructive move, which drives your business to the brink of bankruptcy. At this moment, what would you, who refuses to admit defeat?
Stand out and smack the table. Slam the table and rise out. They think you will back down. Impossible! Dream Chaser can be knocked down, but never knocked out.
Fantastic! But it's a pity. Your friend does not agree.
Seeing that you're
up to your eyeballs in debt, she sees nothing but despair in her future.
I leave Pentaconi in utter disappointment. Is that okay?
Of course, absolutely. I was this close to tears.
What?
Both of. However, the true test is yet to come.
You're about to encounter the harshest judge.
The harshest judge this show has ever seen.
Okay, I don't know what is this.
Welcome to the final stage.
Actually, all the scenarios you previously encountered were all from the film Once Upon a Time in Dream.
Two companions arrive on Pentaconi with nothing but a dream.
Their desire for achievement is met with continuous setbacks.
Ultimately, one continues on despite spiraling into debt. Many years later, their paths cross once more in the thriving Pentaconi. Yet, they refuse.
I became a big shot and she ended up in... I fell into poverty while she's leading in a normal life. Leading a normal life, but she ended up... I don't know. Let's go with the second one.
Against the backdrop of a revitalized Pentaconi, the joy of reunion mixes with the sorrow of past separation, the awkwardness of being strangers, and the shyness of a long-awaited encounter.
all converging at this very moment.
Give it a shot.
Try and convey this bittersweet scene to me. Bring it to life.
Is this ever going to end? I know.
Why don't we try that flower?
Your performance is far from set.
Happy.
God! I never imagined that such a sad scene could be portrayed by you two in such a joyful and heartwarming way. Two people sharing a love.
Huh? But we haven't even done anything!
Brilliant! The portrayal outdoes the original. Beautiful!
Okay, let's
pass the test. We gotta hurry up. Stellaron is at stake.
Oh god. There's a clockwork here. Oh. What the heck is that? Fire. Quantum?
General. No okay. Need.
Let's try to fight a new enemy.
Perhaps you still don't understand. Humanity never conceals its desire to control the heavens, and I'm no exception.
You have the upper hand.
Where's the eye?
Together as one. Enemy data secure. Netmarkers activated. Time for a good old counterattack.
Follow my charge. Conflict is pitiless.
Time for an overhaul.
I got no physics. I ain't got no win. Action advance. Right. Okay.
Commencing support. Ready for another?
Oh god,
Enemy data secured. Netmarkers activated. Time for a good old counterattack!
You won't get away.
All things in this world have their laws. Human creations!
Here, this thunder!
Time for the master stroke.
Show no mercy!
Jackpot? Okay, I don't know what just happened.
The combat report will be ready soon.
Let's repair. Let's try. Okay. Oh wait, hold on, this thing. Okay, done. I don't feel like I wanna go pee. Give me a moment, I need to pause.
Go pee.
Sometimes I think this game is just playing. I mean, just always a long playthrough. TikTok!
Congrats to both of you for clean. Look at the time!
That red hair contestant.
What is that exactly?
You'll find out eventually, but only if you clear the next test first. Welcome to the second stage of the... You have the option to choose Gunfire and undergo Brother Hanu's trial, or Time, where you'll face Clucky's trial. And now...
Okay. Quickly. Time trial? I don't know. Whatever, I don't know what. I worry about time trial is like there's a time limit to accomplish something. gunfire is not good.
Dear friends, welcome to the enchanting universe created by the Watchmaker. Awaiting you is the It is said that these cartoon characters were inspired by the Watchmaker's own experiences. According to research by clocky scholars, the original Hanu of reality shared a deep friend. Enter into the world of Hanu via the TV by the entrance.
If it's a gunfire trial, we should be able to settle this with a fight, right?
Aye.
I hope this won't waste...
Let's power through.
Ready?
Oh no.
1, 2, 3. Are we both?
Very good. In this Hanu's Adventure episode, Boss Stone has gathered his battleships for an assault on Dreamville. Or Buzzfly, Cousin Wolf, and alas, Hanu presently is ill-equipped to fend off the malevolent mischief makers with.
Oh, God.
Oh, brave Hanu! You look like you could really use some help! Long time no see, Hanu. You look pretty stressed out. How about an intense and... Oh, my! Are you telling me that Boss Stone has rallied the villains to seize Dreamville? What a dreadful twist of fate! Listen closely, Hanu. I'm aware you're in need of a suitable weapon. And I also know there's one just upstairs. But you know what? You'll have to play an exhilarating round of Dream Chick.
You have to help me. Yeah, so whatever.
Now scurry along, Hanu, but tread carefully. Two ne'er-do-wells are also- I can't wait to see you finish the-
Let's stay alert, and make sure those monsters don't spot us.
Oh, great. Is someone coming? Brother Hanu, why there's a need of box saying those steps? Chip chip.
Thing down. Do you think that would do the trick?
Okay. Let's go.
Finally, that's all the jigsaw pieces. Let's hurry back.
Wait. Oh, it's just a TV, right? Great. Here.
Oh my! The exquisite sensation of perfect hurry now, Han!
Such haphazard and... disconnecting from that thing so suddenly has left me feeling slightly disoriented.
Again.
Is that Hanu?
Oh. Is this really, is staying in character really necessary? I know the answer is This one,
What exactly is he talking to?
TikTok! It's time for me to make it!
Okay, where do you come from? Ah, the plot thickens, help.
Clocky?
I also can see him.
I can also see him.
It is part of the show.
In Dream Hill, Clocky is everywhere and can do anything! Like right now! I can be your translator! Hanu says, battle!
We must battle.
The enemy is at our doorstep, and we have no path of retreat for the future of Dreamville! Touch that suspicious-looking TV right now!
Ah, great.
So they just jumped.
Sheesh.
Logic in this plot and dial?
When is this gonna be?
I am gradually getting used to this.
Oh, did someone say high-level movies just now? That's right, pal. The upcoming script is Last We Saw, Hanu was preparing for battle. Suddenly, he hears heavy footsteps coming from the hallway. Malevolent mischief makers have but brave Hanu won't go down without a fight.
But we still don't have any weapon.
Guess what? Hanu's favorite bazooka just so happens to be in that storage room.
Okay. Storage room.
The storage room. It's behind the shelves, right? Oh god. Careful. It looks like we've got
what? I'm not done yet. Oh f-
Here we go again. But no big deal. We're pretty.
My god. Luckily, jeez, I'm so crazy. Ah, jeez, fuck. Ah, great.
That should be all of them, right?
Ah, I hope so. Shut up. I'm going to get peace. Ah, when did it end?
Well, that's that.
You know what? I have to stop here, I think. Go to the other place? Is that a save point? I need a save point.
Congratulations to in the final stage. Welcome to the 33rd.
It's already 6. Let's skip this. Whatever, I don't know. Activate it, okay.
No way, I think I just saw someone. Someone extraordinary.
Ah, seriously. Physical, right? Physical eyes and something. Please wait, handsome gentleman, beautiful miss, by the glorious light of beauty. I never thought I would see you again. Redhead contestant is all you. Will you participate in the challenge? Upon hearing the pending festivities, I recommended the one and only to bring me. What? Sorry, I pressed. Come again. Fortunately, Miss Mini Rabbit. You know what? Can you please make way? Saving the world, what a righteous act of beauty. If that's the case, no, that won't do. The rules of contest, blah 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 blah. I don't know what I choose. Oh.
That's right. This magnificent dream is built upon the Stellaron and the countless sacrifices of many.
Oh, to encounter deeds so vile, they stir one's very soul. However, the present day Pentagon bears no marks of the Stellaron stains, and the family has always been renowned and spreading harmony. How can I be sure your words are whole truth? Tell the truth about what? Oh, whatever.
If I'm not wrong, the Knights of Beauty also received an invitation.
That's right, there was. But what does it have to do with this Star?
Actually,
we met the Star Watchmaker. Evidently, you are traveling with the pursuit of the beauty ideals. Go forth, my dear friend, Miss. Blah blah blah.
Thank you, Knight of. In that case, let's make our way to the end. Panicone's really thronging with talent. I hope we make it in time.
You know what? I have to stop this game for today. Sorry, I have to stop here because I need to go out. I have make an appointment with my friend. So hope you guys enjoyed this episode so far. If you like it, please give a thumbs up. If you want to see more, please remember to subscribe to my channel and hit the bell notification. It will notify you whenever there's a new video. Please stay tuned to watch for the next part. I hope you guys enjoy.